to be honest with you, one of the biggest heartbreaks I've ever had is realizing I wasn't what I pretended to be. Mm-hmm. And that's a heartbreak. Mm-hmm. So you have to hit that low bottom, and then from there, you start building up again, reconstructing your dream.
I'd like to welcome to the show Don Miguel Ruiz Jr. How are you doing, Don Miguel?
I'm doing well, Alex. Thank you so much for having me on your show. It's truly an honor. Thank you.
Thank you so much for being on the show as well. We just had our catch up in Spanish right before we started recording, but I do really appreciate you coming on. I've been a fan of your work and of course of your father's work for many years. They're books that when you read them, they almost vibrate off the page. They kind of just hit you like a ton of bricks, especially when you're not expecting it. Which is what a good book does. Yeah. And you just pick up the four agreements. What is this? Self-mastery. What is this? And then you just like, boom, and it just hits you like a ton of bricks. And that's exactly what it should. That's what it's built to do, hopefully.
Yes, it's putting up a mirror in front of you. And it's kind of like having a moment of clarity. And when you have a moment of clarity, you have a choice to continue the cycle or to change direction.
Now, how did you get started on your spiritual journey?
Well, I was born into a family where the main spiritual figure was my grandmother, Madre Sarita. You can say that when people talk that I'm walking in my father's footsteps, I have to correct them. It's my grandma, Sarita. My father and I, my brother, are continuing her dream. This is her image. This is her vision. My grandmother was a spiritual healer, curandera. And she opened up a little temple in Barrio Logan in San Diego, California, in the 1970s. So she is the first one in the family to teach the tradition outside the family. Her father, Don Leonardo, and grandfather, Don Ezequiel, they didn't really teach it outside too much the family because it was still a little bit taboo. But it was my grandma. She had a moment of clarity in her life. She had a moment where she couldn't explain, but she was so grateful for her healing because she was going through she had lost her son. She had gone through some medical issues, and someone in the family took her to see a curandera. And it helped her so much. She was so grateful, but she went to my great-grandfather, Don Leonardo, and began her training with him, and then in Templo Mayor in Mexico City as well. Then she came back to Tijuana because her father was stationed there. He was the military band leader for the cuartel in Tijuana. Cuartel, not cartel, mm-hmm. Cuartel, the military. And she continued to teach there. And she went to the San Diego where she opened up this little temple where she shared a tradition with everyone in the community. She would give her sermons on Thursday and Sunday, but during the week, she would do her healings and consultations. Well, it was into that world where, when I was born, that was already going. You know, my grandmother was already known for that. So I grew up Catholic and Toltec, you can say. Toltec is not a religion, but having gone to my grandma's services, I would still go to services. Mm-hmm. So my grandmother would give her sermons on catedras on Sunday mornings, and I would go. I would be there because I lived with her as well. So for me, she was the center of the family, she and my grandpa, Don Luis. And it was a beautiful thing to grow up with a community that always looks to them for guidance, for health, for prayers, for many things. It was a beautiful thing to witness. And, you know, every Sunday, during the church, people would dress up and they're all in white and they do their songs, their chants, their music, their message, and, you know, shake hands afterwards. And it was beautiful. So the thing about being the eldest of my father's kids is that I remember Dr. Miguel Ruiz. I remember apprentice Miguel Ruiz. And of course, I know Don Miguel Ruiz. I got to witness his transitions, because he was 23 years old when I was born. He was still going to medical school at UNAM, Pumas. And he was my father, my uncle Luis, who's an oncologist, my uncle Carlos, who's a neurologist, my aunt, who's a psychiatrist, my mom was a dentist. On my father's side, you know, the youngest kids were all doctors. So you have all Western medicine, and then you have my grandma with the hierbas and curanderismo, faith healing. So you had two worlds going around. And you can say I grew up in a world of juxtapositions, of dualities. Then my father had his aha moment that made him shift his direction, started learning with my grandma Sarita, mi abuelita Sarita, and my great grandpa, Don Leonardo. Sorry, all the names just got confused there. And began his apprenticeship. So my grandmother set up a group called Ensueño, and began to teach him dreaming every Sunday night. So he would have him meditate for about 3 hours. If he moved, they would start all over again. You know, it's like she had to teach them discipline. So I remember that moment. And at one point, my father decided to no longer be a doctor. At that point, he was a general practitioner, family therapist, and he was about to become a neurosurgeon when he stopped it. And imagine that, going through all that, and all of a sudden have that epiphany and shifting, you know, completely shifting, letting go of that world and solely dedicating himself to teaching the tradition. So I remember that stage. I remember when my dad sold his clinic, his little medical office. It was a nice little medical office in Tijuana where my dad and my uncles all had their own individual offices. It was nice, you know, we walked from school to their office and there they were. My dad stopped that. He became a full-time apprentice and my parents divorced. At that point, of course, you can't blame my mom for that. But at that point, my father began to change the tradition just a little bit because he saw that there was a lot of superstition in it. You know, there was a lot of fanaticism that surrounded my grandmother's kind of like a cloud that surrounded that outer sphere of what she grew. So my dad wanted to put her teachings in a language that was what my dad would call common sense. You can say it's the merger of the East and West in there. That was during the stage of my father's apprenticeship. You know, he put into practice, he got himself a little mirror room and he began to continue his meditations, his ensueños with my grandma in this room full of mirrors and learned how to have the discipline to control his attention and go. And then somewhere on the line, Don Miguel Ruiz showed up. Now, as his son, I saw that reflecting his parenting skills. Dr. Miguel Ruiz demanded straight A's, for example. He was very much a disciplinarian, very much like, oh, you gotta give me straight A's. In Mexico, it's tense. You know, I lived in San Diego. I crossed the border to Tijuana to go to school in Tijuana. So that's, you know, I kind of did it opposite. Mm-hmm. Then apprentice Don Miguel Ruiz was different. All of a sudden, he was not so strict with the tens, but he became a little bit more of a between that strictness and a laissez-faire type of thing. You know, it's like, all right, this is your life. This is your education. I'm here to help you, but this is your life. From now on, this is basically, I'm going from 9th to 10th grade. My dad says, you are now responsible for your education. I'm not going to drive you to school to sign you up. I'm not going to go and search for the teacher. I'm not going to do this. This is your education. And that's the way my father teaches. You know, if he wanted to learn how to swim, he just pushed you into the pool and says, swim. Bob, I can't swim. Swim. But dad, I can't swim. Miguel, your head's above water. You're swimming. Oh, I'm doggy paddling, but. So that's the way my father teaches. Then Don Miguel Ruiz style of parenting. Granted, I was somewhere in my senior year of high school or junior or college, where all of a sudden his approach to parenting was more of a, I am here to help you, but I know you can do this yourself. He basically let me experience the consequences of every choice I made from that degree, basically. So in those three styles, and granted, I was a totally different age during the whole thing, but what he expected of me changed with everything. I say this because in my experience with spirituality, you had my grandma, who was the figurehead of the family, who I apprenticed with for 10 years. That was my job. When I got initiated into the Toltec tradition when I was 14 years old, my father says, I'm going to teach you once you start and finish college. In the meantime, your grandmother's going to be your teacher, and you're going to do it by translating everything she says. You're going to help her in everything she does. My grandmother spoke no English. It was only Spanish. And I translated her lectures, her sermons, her consultations, her prayers, everything. I was just, and she had to basically teach me how to focus my attention in her own unique way with me. So that was my upbringing, a combination of academia with spirituality, Tijuana and San Diego, and a family that was completely involved in spirituality and at the same time very involved with our everyday life. So that's my background in that. And then I graduated college and my father intensified my teachings. And you can say it's something called you shift the assemblage point, where he put me in a place where I questioned everything I knew and had to start from the very beginning, you know, be able to detach from everything I know, give it scrutiny, basically applying the fifth agreement, be skeptical, but learn to listen with everything and see life as is, and letting go of that identity that I've created. And to be honest with you, one of the biggest heartbreaks I've ever had is realizing I wasn't what I pretended to be. Mm-hmm. And that's a heartbreak. Mm-hmm. So you have to hit that low bottom. And then from there, you start building up again, reconstructing your dream. And that's my background.
So in many ways, your grandmother was like Bruce Lee, because she had teachings that were only supposed to be in her own culture, her own family, but yet she taught other people as well.
Yep.
And same for your father. So yes. they're both kind of spiritual Bruce Lees.
In a way, yes. And that's the thing. It's like in 2007, she was inducted into the San Diego Women's Hall of Fame. She was inducted into this Hall of Fame in San Diego because they recognized that she kept this tradition alive. You know, when my father started, it was my grandmother who was famous. Everyone knew who, or at least in that community, knew who Madre Sarita was, and not just in San Diego, but basically anyone who was into spirituality at the time. And my dad had that, you know, that expectation. And he just, if my grandmother opened the gates, my father destroyed the gates.
Yeah, pretty much, no question. Now, for everyone listening, can you talk a little bit about what Toltec wisdom is and the philosophy of Toltec, of Toltec?
Sure. Well, the word Toltec is a Nahuatl word that, if I translate it into English, it means artist, artesano, artisan. So if I translate the phrase, the Toltec art of transformation, into 100% English, it means the artist path of transformation. I'm an artist. And the canvas for my work of art is my life. And the instruments I'm going to use to create that work of art is going to be my body, my intent, my will, my mind, my yes, and my no. And with these instruments, I can create the most perfect nightmare or the most harmonious dream. So imagine a work of art that changes and shifts with every choice I make. So to paraphrase my grandmother during my apprenticeship, this is the question she would always ask me. Do you control knowledge, or does knowledge control you? And she would always change that question. You know, is the bottle drinking you, or you drinking the bottle, or type of thing? You know, so she would always try to find a way to put it back in that direction. Do you control knowledge, or does knowledge control you? When I was 14 years old, I had no idea. But as I grew older, when knowledge controls me, is I'm completely conditioned or domesticated by the environment that surrounds me, the family, the culture, into saying yes and no to what they want me to do, which means the work of art I'm creating is not my work of art, it's someone else's work of art, someone else's point of view, someone else's expectation, someone else's prejudice, someone else's projection of how I'm supposed to be. You can say that the main problem that the Four Agreements and every single one of our books deals with is domestication, which is a system of reward and punishment by which we model the behavior of an individual, where if you live up to the expectation, you're worthy of our reward. And if you fall short of it, you're worthy of the punishment. Since we are emotional beings, that reward feels like acceptance, which feels like love. And the punishment feels like rejection and the lack thereof of love. It's the way we've learned to love conditionally. I love you if. But if you begin to regain control of your yes and your no, regain control of your intent, the impeccability of your word, or the impeccability of yourself, impeccability of your intent, then it goes back to I control knowledge. And knowledge is the instrument by which I inform my choices, but I'm the one making the choice. You can say is me creating the work of art that is my life by my choice, based on everything I've learned, but it's my choice as opposed to the condition or projection that I was supposed to do according to whatever conditioning or domestication I had. So that's basically at the very basis of it. Am I creating the most perfect nightmare, or am I creating the most beautiful, harmonious dream? And is it really your dream? Is it your experience?
Now, what I wanted to kind of go into a little deeper into what you just said, because, and I know where you're coming from, but I know a lot of people might be thinking this listening. You made the assumption, or at least the statement, that you are the creator of the nightmare or the dream, where most people believe that life happens to them and that they don't control what happens to them. Mm-hmm. Now, to a certain extent, there are certain things that a car accident and death in the family, a relationship doesn't work out. Those are things that are somewhat out of our control many times. Mm-hmm. But yet how you deal with them is in your control. Mm-hmm. Can you kind of dive into that just a little bit?
Sure. If I can, from my interpretation of the question, you can say that I am a co-creator with everything in life. Now, as a co-creator, I only control to the tips of my fingers.
That's great.
I don't control the will of another. I don't control the perception of another. I only control my perception, and I only control my will. It's like, imagine me and my wife. When I say me and my wife put our fingers like this, she controls to the tips of her fingers. I control to the tips of mine. To respect her is to respect her yes and her no. Her no is just as powerful as your yes, as her yes. The thing is, in order for me to respect her no, I have to learn how to respect my no. It's like learning how to say namaste. In order for me to say the sun in me honors the sun in you, I first learned how to honor my own sun. So I know from that experience of what it feels like to honor my own sun, to honor someone else's. The sun in me honors the sun in you, namaste. So you can say you first learn how to respect someone else's will or perception by learning how to respect your own. My no is just as powerful as my yes, because my wife's is just as, her no is just as powerful as her yes. In fact, the relationship between me and my wife only exists for as long as we both say yes. The moment one of us changes that yes into a no, the relationship ceases to exist, which means every relationship I am in, be it romantic, be it by family, be it by friendships, only exists because two people with a complete free will are saying yes to one another. As soon as that yes turns into a no, it ceases to exist. So from that point of view, I'm a co-creator with her. And in the same term, I'm a co-creator with life. Life has all the right to say no to me. I can prepare myself for something. I can work really hard for something. But if life says no, that won't be done. If life says yes, which is what we know as an opportunity, I'm ready for it. So from that point of view, I am the constant in every relationship that I am in. And the only thing I control in all those relationships is myself. I don't control anyone I'm in relationship with. So here's the thing. The only thing that will exist between my wife and I So that's an example, are the things we both say yes to. If she says no to something or I say no to something, it won't be a part of our relationship. The only thing that will exist are the things we both mutually say yes. The word agreement is a word that reflects the action of saying yes. That's what an agreement is. So we can say that the fabric of our relationship, as we mutually respect each other, are based on the things we mutually say yes to one another with peace and respect. And you won't find anything in our relationship that either one of us said no. You'll find compromises. You'll find agreements. When you love someone, set them free. Well, that means simply means that I don't control their will or I don't control their perception. They do. They have every freedom to go in any direction in life. That's to me what that set them free means. Don't try to control or impose their will upon them, because eventually they're going to say no to something you want to say yes to. And at that moment, you'll be tempted to cross that line of respect, because at that moment, we want that yes. And we try so much to do it that we try to control their will. The only thing that exists before us is that mutual agreement. If she says no, to respect her is to respect her being. So I'm going to still use my words to try to convince her to change her point of view. I'm going to write an essay. I'm going to write a review. And if she likes the way I see things, she might change that yes into a no. But for as long as she says no, that won't be done. But if I get attached to that yes and I really want it, that's when I begin that temptation to try to impose my will and subjugate her. You made this mistake. You made that mistake. Let me think for you. That's what gaslighting really is. The ability to control someone else's will by making them doubt themselves, to make them doubt their own capacity to say yes and no. And if they believe you, they subjugate their will. It's called imposing and subjugation. Every parasite will find his or her perfect host. This looks like peace, but it's not peace. It's complete lack of respect, because I disrespect her will and she disrespected her will because she used my words subjugate herself because she believed it. That's what gaslighting is. But what we normally see is a battle of who is going to domesticate who, who's going to control who, because whoever controls the yes and no of a relationship controls the relationship. And that's what we normally see in the world in trying to control it. So from that point of view, whoever's afraid of the no, whoever's afraid of not getting what they want, is going to be the one who's trying to control others. We can say that's when we become parasites or active domesticators or condition people who condition someone to go against themselves, especially myself. I can't give what I do not have. So from that point of view, that is where the moment of clarity comes in. One of my favorite quotes is from Eleanor Roosevelt, the First Lady. No one can make you feel inferior without your consent. Mm-hmm. To paraphrase it, no one can make me feel inferior without my consent. No one can condition me or domesticate me without my consent. How do we give consent? By believing it, by believing that judgment, by believing those things. It's kind of like the image of Siddhartha. Mm-hmm. When Siddhartha faces Mara and it does not give in to the temptation of the three daughters, Mara gets so mad and angry that he sends his armies to destroy Siddhartha, and they shoot their arrows at him. Siddhartha looks at those arrows and turns them into roses. I do not give you permission to hurt me. I'm not giving those arrows permission to make me feel inferior. He did not give in to the illusion. You can say from that point, he faced Mara, which is his own reflection, the distortion of his own reflection, and became the Buddha. In our life, you can say life is constantly happening. There are 7.5 billion human beings living life at this very moment, all with free will, whether they know it or not. They're yes and they're no. Some of their will is subjugated, some of it is conditioned, some of them, they know what they're doing. But 7.5 billion people and our relationship with all of them will be unique to each individual that we are in, because I'm the constant. And here's the thing. I don't control the will of another individual, just as I don't control their perception. what do I control? Myself. I control my will. I control my perception. And once I realize that, it's about regaining control, regaining that ability to make a choice, regaining that ability to take responsibility and empower myself with my yes and my no, to respect my no just as much as I respect my yes, to respect this body, to respect this being, and to heal from the wounds of conditional love left in my heart, because I've realized that all those wounds are making me react. And I'm reacting with that anger, and I'm trying to impose my will upon someone else. And that's where the nightmare continues. So if I want that nightmare to end, it starts within me, because that's what I control. That's what I, that's my contribution. So from that point of view, once I begin to heal, and the best way to let go of conditional love is to forgive ourselves for ever saying yes to it in the first place. Kind of like the image of Siddhartha forgiving himself for allowing one arrow to hit its target. And the only reason why that arrow hit is because he believed. But now that he becomes aware of it, he forgives himself. I forgive myself for believing in it. I forgive myself for that. You can say this is not learning how to not take things personal. That I assume that the behavior of another is not because of me. Because I don't control their will. I don't control their perception. They do. And that's what I mean by that. The respect that every individual sees life as unique as they are and express their choices as unique as they are. But what I can control is this. If I am the constant in every relationship that I am in, if I already have that disturbance, that relationship that is in disharmony, then I'm always going to be the constant for disharmony in every relationship, because that's all I can give. But if I begin to do the work of healing, of letting go, of unlearning that which doesn't let me to heal, and I get to the point where I'm at peace with myself, that I master myself. And what I mean by mastering is simply that I put into practice everything I've learned to heal and accept myself. That's what I mean by master. I stop pretending to be something I am not and accept myself for who I am, the sum of every choice I've ever made and the youngest I will ever be. When I get to that point, when I'm at peace with myself, when I've forgiven myself, that peace becomes the constant opportunity with every relationship that I am in, because I can't give what I do not have. Once that relationship changes, my relationship with each one changes. That doesn't mean I'm going to change them. Some people still see me as that high school kid. There's people who still see my father as Dr. Miguel Ruiz. They still have wounds with him from when he did sometime when he was 18 or 23 years old. And one of my favorite examples of that is that me and my wife were talking to one of my uncles and my aunt, and we were having our first adult conversation, because my uncle, my aunt, and my uncle were talking to me as a peer, as opposed to a nephew. We were talking about, you know, life. And at one point, my uncle said, "Miguel, there's a great book that's out there that's great for couples. It's called The Four Agreements. You should read it. Don't listen to your dad, but read the book." And the reason why my uncle said that is that my uncle still has that memory of who my father used to be a long time ago. And sometimes people will still see you for who you are. It's something that most addicts or alcoholics go through. You know, it's like they have their aha moment. They have the moment of clarity. They go through the process. When they go back to their world and to re-engage the community, their family, there'll be people who will give them the opportunity, the benefit of doubt, who they are now. And then there'll be those people who still have those old wounds that don't trust it. And there are some people who are, well, that's what you think, but I know you're going to relapse. And once you relapse, I know you're wrong. You know, and that kind of thing. Someone who goes through that is dealing with people who remember who they were and they still want to project that old image. And you have people who will see you for who you are. You can't control it. Kind of like in the nature of the question, there's things in life we can't control that happen. What I do control is how I respond to that, how I react to that, how I let it be something that I will use to reinforce whatever doubt I have, or I will use it to learn from. Like one of my favorite examples of how not to take it personal is like, imagine me when I'm younger and I used to be really afraid of talking to girls and ask them out, you know,
because
I'm afraid of the rejection, right? Mm-hmm. You go ask and they say no. And you feel terrible, you feel horrible. As time progresses and I look back, the reason why it hurt is because I'm using their words to reinforce whatever insecurity I already had. If I actually had respect for them at the time, it's their no. They're sharing their truth with me. They're telling me I am not their preference. They're not into me. Like Berger from Sex and the City says, he's not that into you. It's the truth. They're sharing their truth. I am not their type. And they're saying the truth. How I'm receiving that. Oh, I'm ugly, I'm fat, I'm this, I'm that. I'm reinforcing whatever insecurity I have. So you can say it from that point of view. They have every right to say no. No means no. But I take it personally because now I'm going to use that no to reinforce whatever insecurity I have of myself, whatever judgment I have of myself, and just say I'm not worthy of love because of this and that, and she just proved it. It had nothing to do with her. All she did was say her truth. Looking back, I realized that that's what I was doing. That's what really hurt about that.
Right.
That I tied who I am based on someone else's point of view. Mm-hmm. And if she said yes, I'm, you know, more confident, feel good. She said no, I'm just, you know, through the floors. And it took me a long time to realize, is there just point of view? And then I translated that to work. I translated that to relationships, other things in life, you know, getting rejected from a job offer. I'm so qualified, yes, but the person who was doing the interview has to look for not just the quality of your work, but will you be a good fit with my team? And that's the kind of thing. Or someone who's doing a audition for a film. I'm a great actor. Why can't they say no? Like, because they're looking at the chemistry of not just you, but the whole cast and how they flow together. It's not personal. They're just looking for this thing that fits. So from that point of view, you know, if an actor goes to that, it's like, I know that I'm good. I can use that no from that rehearsal to make me feel inferior, or just simply say, I wasn't their fit. That's fine. I'll find for something that does. So going back to that question, yes, tragedies happen. Accidents happen. Life has us no. People say this. People say that. How am I going to respond to that? How am I going to interact? What's my contribution to all that? And that's what I mean, that we control this unique individual that is me. What do I contribute to the community? Well, I contribute what I have. If I have this harmony, pure tumultuous relationships, unbalanced and things like that, or I start with respect because I have that respect for myself and I have respect for other people. And if this opportunity doesn't arise, I will still continue to do my work until life says yes to me.
Now, let me ask you, you mentioned something in your last answer, which was about letting go of the person. You, when people come into your life, sometimes you look at them as who they were 20 years ago, not who they are currently. Do you have any suggestions on how to let go of anger or pain that someone else has done to you? Maybe 20 years ago, maybe 30 years ago, and you still won't let go of who that person is. I mean, to the point where the person that's in front of you might be sick, might be incapable of giving you what you want in life, like an apology or a recognition or anything like that. So now you've lost that opportunity to even be able to confront the person about the pain that they caused you. How can you personally let that go so it doesn't affect your day-to-day life?
Well, it all comes down to forgiveness. Any process and work that one does reaches that one pivotal moment of forgiveness. If you're not ready to forgive, that's fine. That's your truth. I'm not ready to forgive. I have this wound and it's there. But if you're ready to let go of it, forgiveness is key. Now, I'm going to use the description of forgiveness that someone taught me. This is not mine. Someone else taught it, and I'm just saying it because it's beautiful. Forgiveness is the moment you no longer wish the past was any different. It is the moment you accept it and you let it go. That's what forgiveness is. In a way, from that, it's the moment you realize that you can't go back in the past and change a yes to a no or no to a yes, because life no longer exists in the past. In fact, the past only exists in your memory, and it probably didn't happen the way you think it happened, but the wound is there. And that's the thing about the past. It only exists in our mind as a memory, just like the future only exists in our imagination with what ifs. The only thing that exists without my mind is this present moment. So it's the moment you realize I can't go back there and change things. It's the moment where it happens. Now, so the second part of that expression, you accept it and you let it go. I'm going to use my brother Jose's analogy, a metaphor of a scorpion that has decided to no longer sting itself with its own tail, administering the poison that it meant for someone else onto itself. And what I mean by that is that imagine a scorpion, or imagine us like a scorpion, that every time we think of the past, of that moment, of that person, of that whatever, we're stinging ourselves again and again and again and again with our own tail, administering to ourselves that emotional poison that we meant for someone else, but we're drinking it ourselves because we keep hitting it, we keep feeling it, and it impacts us. It makes our life feel horrible. It's just, we feel the pain all over again, again and again and again and again. The moment you accept it and you let it go is basically the moment I no longer sting myself with my own emotional poison. Someone said to me, yeah, but scorpions don't do that. Exactly. Scorpions actually don't do that, but we do every time we think about it. So it gets to the point where, do you want to continue with it? Usually when I say, are you ready to forgive? If you're not ready, it's because you're still using this poison, because sometimes we've identified ourselves with it. Sometimes it fuels our anger, which makes us think that we are powerful, but we're not. It's just a crutch. But it still hurts. So the question comes in is, are you ready to let go of the hurt? If you are, taking a step forward and using the full spectrum of everything humanity has created, from therapists, from a cognitive behavioral therapist, to whatever it is, medications, ayahuasca, or processing, or talking, or healing, or talking to your priest, your minister, your rabbi. There's so many paths that can take you. You just have to find the one that resonates with you. But ultimately, it comes down to that moment of acceptance. I can't go back in the past and change it. Life no longer is there. Do I want to continue to hurt myself with it? Mind you, it doesn't mean that I'm not going to learn from it. Of course, I'm going to learn from it. But am I going to continue to drink that emotional poison that I've been giving myself over and over again? Because it's no longer that person who gave that initial dosage that's giving me. It's me every time I think about it, hitting my own. Again, I'm creating my own trauma. There's trauma that was caused by moments. You know, there's the moments where I hydroplaned and I almost killed my whole family in a storm in San Diego, having tires that didn't have enough thread. You know, so that's the thing about Southern California. Sometimes we're lazy about our tires, and when that rain comes, we lose them. So every time I feel that sensation of hydroplaning, my whole body just goes, you know, a little form of thing. I'm not really in that situation, but my body has that memory. But sometimes PTSD comes from that. There's PTSD that comes from an actual wound, an emotional wound. Then there's the PTSD that we create from our own what ifs or taking things personal. Either way, whether it came from a real moment or something we created, it all comes to an end when we choose, actually, when we give ourselves the permission to heal and we find that thing that resonates. It could be a Toltec tradition, it could be therapy, it could be whatever it is. There's so many versions. We just go to the one that resonates with us. And we heal. And we let go, which means I no longer identify myself with that moment. I will learn from that moment, but I will no longer use it to hurt myself.
Now, there's so much the inner voice, the monkey brain, as has been said, that inner voice. So much it does so much to harm us. Sometimes it beats us up so much. We're so hard on ourselves. Mm-hmm. I forgot who said it, but it says like if you had someone in your life who spoke to you like you speak to yourself, you would never want to be have that person in your life.
Yeah.
it's so true. So what advice do you have? First of all, the first question is, why do we beat ourselves up so much? What is the purpose? And secondly, how do you tame that inner voice, the negative inner voice?
Okay, so I'll do it the way my father did it with me. When I was young, he would ask me, this is part of my apprenticeship, so I'll share that with you.
Thank you.
My father would say, Miguel, if you're the voice that's thinking inside your mind, who's listening? I said, I am. Oh, really? You're the one listening. Then who's talking inside your mind when you're thinking? And I answered, I am. And that's the individual dream. It's the relationship between me and me. You can say it's my heart, my mind talking to my heart, or left hemisphere or right hemisphere, whichever way metaphor you want to use. But in that inner dialogue, I am the voice that's talking and I am the one who's listening. It is here that if there's disharmony, there will be disharmony everywhere. But if there's harmony there, I'm the constant opportunity for that harmony in every relationship I am in. That monkey brain. The monkey brain is just another word to describe it. The monkey brain is talking, but I'm the one listening. But I am the monkey brain. Why does it used to get beat up? Well, it's because we're used to it. We've become masters of it. Someone domesticated us, and we continue to domesticate ourselves. The example I have in my book, The Mastery of Self, is that of my grandma. Imagine me at the age of 8, and I'm learning how to assert myself, which means I'm learning how to say yes and no. And it feels powerful to say no. It feels good to say no. Because up to this point, I'm just doing everything my parents are telling me, but now I'm saying no. And here comes my grandma with a bowl of soup, and she puts it right in front of me. She goes, here you go, mijo. This soup will make you big and strong. And I go, no. But honey, this soup will make you big and strong like Papa, like Superman. Don't you want to be like Papa and Superman? No. Now, at that moment, my grandma's thinking about nutrition. She knows that soup is good for me. So she tries to go into a memory bank and think what worked before. I got it. Here comes the plane, mijo. She grabs a spoonful of soup and she tries to put it in my mouth. No. I just purse my lips and I go, no. No, 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 you know. And with every no I give, little and little, it stops being about nutrition, and little and by little starts being about control. She wants that yes. So she goes, mijo, don't you know how many kids don't have anything to eat here in Mexico and around the world? And here you are wasting food. Honey, it's a sin to waste food. Mm-hmm. For one, I don't want to look like a selfish child in front of my grandmother's eyes, but I really don't want to look like a sinner. So I go, yes, grandma, I'll eat the soup. And I begin to eat the soup. And as I finish, my grandma comes over. She says, that's my good boy. I get the reward. Not only that I don't want to look like a sinner in her eyes, I don't want to look like a selfish child, but here's the thing. Ever so innocently, she got me to change that no into a yes. Basically, my own will got subjugated. I got domesticated. Fast forward 38 years later. I keep forgetting to add that number. 38 years later, and I go to a Mexican restaurant, and they give me a plate this big of food. At least they call it Mexican food. And halfway through, my body tells me the truth. I am full. I'm satisfied. I can't eat another bite. But I believe conscious or subconscious says, and I hear that voice, it's a sin to waste food.
Yeah.
Conscious or subconscious, I say, yes, grandma. And I continue to eat. And I polish that plate and I'm so stuck, you have to roll me out. But in that moment of clarity where my body told me the truth, that I'm full, that I'm satisfied, I believe overruled me. And I went against myself as I continued to eat. And it was subconscious. What makes it subconscious is that we've done it so many times, we no longer think about it. It becomes an automatic action or reaction. Mm-hmm. I mastered this condition. Don't be a sinner. Don't waste food. Now, here's the thing. My grandma is nowhere around. In fact, my grandma passed away in 2008. But I can still hear it. And the reason why is because we humans, as far as we know, are the only beings that are able to self-domesticate. When we domesticate a dog or a cat, cats domesticate us, never mind, dogs. We have to be actively domesticating them. But if they ever get out and go out in the wild, they go back to being what they always were, dogs, in order for them to survive. They'll retain some of the trauma here or there of their domestication, but by and large, they'll go back to being what they were. We humans, when our active domesticators or people who conditioned us stop doing that, meaning the last time they physically, actively said anything, we continue to domesticate ourselves. It's in their voice, but that monkey mind takes on many voices of every domesticator in our life. Mm-hmm. But it's been me. And in this case, my grandmother only said that to me once in my life when I was 8. I've been telling it to myself over and over again for 38 years. So you can say, and I'm going to make the assumption that the vast majority of us, of that monkey mind being so hard on us, there's probably more, but I'm going to use this example, is that we've gotten used to it. We continued to believe whoever judged us, whoever criticized us, we can continue to believe those friends who judged us for wearing a certain type of clothes or making fun of us for listening to a certain type of music or not knowing a certain kind of movie or voting a certain way or dressing a certain way or not using the word or not identifying yourself in this way. They said that once, but the only reason why it's still in our minds is that we're still believing it. And then here again, once again, forgiveness comes in, forgiving myself for ever saying yes to it in the first place.
Fantastic answer, sir. It really makes you think about that inner voice and about why it continues to go again and again. There's so many times in our lives that we have difficult times, turmoil, again, just things happening to us. How do you center yourself in the middle of chaos, in the middle of craziness that happening in your life? And it could be a million different things.
Yeah. Well, I can say in my life right now, I'm in the middle of turmoil. I'm in a place where my son has autism. He's 16 years old, going on 17, and he's going through a bit of a rough patch right now. We've discovered he's getting cluster headaches, along with allergies, and the altitude is not helping him. So we're gonna have to take him to a lower. But my daughter is doing phenomenal at school. She is doing great. But to move her now down there would be chaotic for her. It would be such a terrible thing. You know, it's like the whole idea of keeping the family together. Well, okay, which one of my children am I going to sacrifice for that? Because my daughter's doing phenomenal. Right. She's got her group. She's doing great academically. Then my son, my wife is going through a little bit of that emotional trauma from, you know, with my son, you know, it's been rough. Then my father is about to go into with his heart, you know, he has some issues with his heart again. Mm-hmm. He may have to go get another heart transplant. There's another thing with my mom. She's starting to show signs of forgetting her memory. My grandmother died. She had Alzheimer's for the last 18 years. And I'm starting looking at that. Like we're like, is she going to have it or not? Like, is this just the age? Is it whatever? Is this that trauma of it? Then you have all these things. Then you're in the middle of it and you feel like you're being pulled in so many directions, because I'm in the stage in my life where my parents need me, my kids need me, and my wife needs me. Yes. Now, here's the thing. In my life, I have no anxiety about me. I'm mm-hmm. in complete peace with me. The only anxiety I have in my life is about my kids, you know, as the parent, you know. I've never felt fear like the moment I held my son for the first time in my arms and realized it. Like, I was holding him in my arms, and I was in complete bliss and just in peace. Then the thought, sudden infant death syndrome, came into my mind. Yeah. I'm telling you,
we all have it.
And I was like, nothing happened. Nothing happened in the room. I was just holding him, and I felt paralyzing fear. So I have that, you know, I've been working through that since my kids were born, and my son's mm-hmm. almost 17 years old, but I've gotten better with it, but never really goes away. But you've learned, and I've learned to process it. You have that. I'm there for my wife. My father and my mom are, my mom's 7 years old. My dad's going to turn 70 in August. And my brothers, you know, they have their families. They're one of things. My aunt just got out of the hospital. I lost 5 uncles to COVID. One classmate from elementary school. Life happens. It's kind of like the last question, you know, it's like, there's a lot of things that are happening. I can use all of them to fuel my anxiety. I can use all of them to make me feel terrible about myself. I can use all of it to make me feel like a victim. I can use all of that to get depressed about things. But if I do, then someone else will need to rescue me. You see, in order to rescue someone who's stuck in the mud, let's use this metaphor or analogy. If someone's stuck in the mud, the best way to help them is to stay on solid ground and extend your hand. If you jump into the mud with them, now the only way one can get out is by pushing the other one down and using them to prepare yourself up, to take yourself out.
Right.
So jumping into the mud with them is not going to help. You have to be able to stay in firm ground, and here's my hand if you need my help. Because I know you can get out, but here's my hand if you need it. That's what compassion is. Pity is thinking, poor you, you can't do it yourself. Let me carry it for you. Let me carry this weight of the world for you, because I don't think you can do it. That's what pity is. I have complete disrespect of you because I don't think you can do it. Let me do it for you. Compassion is, I know you can do it, but here's my hand if you need help. I'm not going to carry the weight for you, but I'm going to help you with it. Kind of like spotting at a gym, if that analogy is able to help. To stay in that solid ground is be able to take care of yourself, to nurture your body, to do the work that allows you to find that peace. Remember that to not take things personal is not to assume responsibility for someone else's will or perception. They are. But here's my hand to help. So as I do this, I'm not the one with autism. My son is. I'm not the one going through being a teenage girl in these times. My daughter is. I'm not my wife. I'm not my father and my mother, and all three of them are going through what their stage in life is. My father, my mother, they're trying to figure out how to be 70 years old and getting to the point where like they still want to be independent, but they're realizing they need a little bit more help. So they're like, the roles between parent and child is shifting. My mom one day, the other day, told me, Miguel, you're not my father. And I says, I know, mom, but I'm here to help you. And she just said, no, don't take away my independence. Meaning like I was trying to help, but mm-hmm. My wife, the same thing. She is going through her journey. We're in the stage of being parents of teenagers. We're approaching 50s in a few years. What is life? So from that point of view is, okay, I can't help anyone if I sink in the mud or I lose myself in my anxiety or depression. I'm going to take care of myself. I'm going to do the things that allow me to have that ability to take care of them. My brother Jose, I love Jose's metaphors. He comes from some good ones up. This one is phenomenal. It's like, imagine you have you're scuba diving and you have only so much oxygen in your tank. So you're constantly monitoring. And when you have, what the monitor lets you know how long you can stay underwater, and the monitor will let you know when it's time to start ascending. And you have to do it. You have to be smart about it because you can't go up fast. You're going to get sick. You have to, all right, I have to do this kind of like this and take my time and be able to adapt my body as I go up. Imagine that metaphor going into family. You know, there are certain people who you react to. Your emotional body lets you know, basically it's an oxygen monitor letting you know how much time you have before you start taking things personal, before you react. And at that moment, you take yourself out. But you keep going in because they're your family. You love them. My son, my daughter, my wife, my father, my mom, I love them all. I love them very much. I'm not going to carry the weight for them. But I'm going to do the work that allows me to be with them and help them. So right now, my son is going to be going down to sea level. My daughter's going to stay in that school, and me and my wife are going to go back and forth to help each other until one of them graduates, which is probably going to be my daughter in this case, because my son's going to go to school till he's 22. And then we'll be able to concentrate on that. But for the meantime, this is what our kids need. And we let go of that obstacle that didn't allow us to do that. And we allowed ourselves the ability to have put us in a place that allows us to help them. So the world is in chaos.
Yeah.
And I realized that it's in chaos because the people I love is that hurricane. So my father always described this. Imagine you're the center of the hurricane. If you put all yourself out in the outer rims of the hurricane, or even near the center in the middle, you're going to get swept away. But if you stay in the center, in the eye of the hurricane, where there's peace, you'll be better able to manage the hurricane. And then I realized the hurricane exists because of me. I'm always at the center of the hurricane. And it's up to me whether it's a category 1 or category 5 or just a tropical storm. But the only reason why there is that hurricane is that I'm surrounded by people who are living their own lives, and I've invested in myself emotionally to them. And I can intensify it with my anxiety, or I can take it down to a category 1 or even a tropical storm by staying centered, by taking care of myself, not taking things personal. You know, my son is the perfect teacher for not taking things personal. In his blowouts, even with his, when he bites me or he hits me or does this, it's not him that's doing it. It's, well, physically he is, but he's just, that's how he's responding to pain. You know, mm-hmm. Cluster headaches. The doctor described a cluster headache like, imagine getting an ice pick shoved into your eye as you have a brain freeze at the same time.
Oof.
That's how it was described.
Thing.
So imagine all of a sudden, and they come out of nowhere. So you have this thing, he can't talk, so there's nowhere out, so he just gets a little aggressive. So we figure it out. We change what we have to do, and now that we know, we're going to make the changes. It's not personal, because right. when he feels great, he's a very loving kid. He's a wonderful kid, and he's learning how to cope. Am I making excuses for him? From my point of view, it does look like it, but from my point of view, it's basically is the instruments I'm going to use to not take it personal, because when he bites, it hurts.
Wow.
Emotionally and physically, of course. But I still love this kid, and I'm going to teach him consequences. Of course, he's every time he does this, he gets a consequence. But I'm not going to say you're a bad kid. We're going to judge him. Even though like the anger comes in and your voice comes up, it's like learning how to control your emotion, because I don't have autism.
Right.
I'm in my place. So how do I stay centered? And I wish I could say that the storm didn't come. It came. But helping him, taking care of him, giving him the chance to heal, it's all about it. Like today, he had a bad one. So we and the humanities teachers, okay, let's do this, let's do that. And we put it in any way, situation where we don't set him up for failure. So he's feeling good. Like what we did today worked. Gracias a Dios.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just my son. And I add my daughter, mm-hmm. add my wife,
add parents.
My parents. Then extend that to my outer family, extend it to my responsibilities as an author or as a lecturer, or as this, that. Tax time just came and went. property taxes are coming, the HOAs, the dogs, and it's
a lot.
It's a mitote. So where do you stay? Where do you stay? Where's your attention? Where, what do you control? Me.
To the tips of your fingers.
Yep, to the tip of my fingers. And how I engage, this is what I'm talking about. How am I going to co-create? Am I going to add to that storm? Or am I going to be able to slowly calm it? You know, be there, stay on solid ground, and like in the case of the mud. And that's where basically you begin to apply everything you've learned. You know, when life gets tough, you applied everything you learned to keep the story moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
When life is good, you apply everything you've learned to enjoy it.
There's a concept that I've heard you discuss called mastering death so you can be alive. Can you kind of dive into that a little bit?
Yeah. Well, it comes from my father and I. When he really began to step up his apprenticeship with me, we were at the top of the pyramid of the sun, a very strong experience for me. And at the end of that experience, my father says, now go home, master death by becoming alive. From that point of view, is realizing that my biggest fear is not death, it's life. First, with death, every relationship ends. Either by choice, by life, or by death. My wife and I are together. This little ring of mine only has meaning because we're both saying yes at the same time. At the moment one of us changes that yes into a no, this just becomes a meaningless object. It just changes. But for now, thank God, she's saying yes. But any given moment, if I do something stupid, she has every right to change that yes into a no. So from that point of view, that's what we know as a breakup. And most of us have experienced that. A relationship ended by choice. When a relationship ends by life, it's the example like I have me and my college girlfriend. I graduated college. She graduated from college. She went to live back to Berlin. I stayed in California. And these are the days before Facebook or social media. So you know, we just went our ways. We never really broke up, but we just said goodbye at the airport in San Francisco. That's, and our relationship ended. By death, well, one day my wife and I will see the other one close their eyes for the last time. Here's the thing. That day is not today. Why worry about a day that's going to come? It's going to come, but it's not today. I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to enjoy it because one day I'm not going to take this body with me. My grandmother taught me that. My uncle taught me that when they passed away. Their bodies are there, but they are not there. I am not this body. I'm not this mind. I'm the force that animates it. Where do we go after we, who knows? I grew up Catholic, which means we believe we all go back to God. Or my father's metaphor of, imagine that you're a single drop in the ocean and you live your whole life thinking that you are only this little droplet of water in the ocean. And the moment you pass away, your whole perception expands to that of the whole ocean. That's a beautiful image, but I'll find out if it's the truth when it happens to me. So what happens when I close my eyes? I'm going to go where every single one of my ancestors have gone. But that day is not today. Today, I'm alive. My wife is saying yes. My family is saying yes. I'm saying yes to this relationship with me. Why waste it with my fear of the what if? This is my truth. This is my present. Let me enjoy it. It's the thing that allows me not to take for granted the relationships I'm in or the person I'm in relationship with. Just like I don't take this body for granted. It's because it's so easy to take it for granted when we forget about that. It's going to come to an end. Today, I'm the youngest I will ever be. I have my whole life ahead of me. How do I want to live it? How do I want to engage it? And I know I'm the youngest because if you take a picture of me right now, in a few years, when I look at it, I'm going to say, look at how young I was. Look at how much hair I had. And the reason why I say that is because I look at pictures of someone who took of me before, and I'm already saying, look at how young I was. I'm young. How do I want to live life? How do I want to engage it? That's what makes me the infinite possibility. I can go in any direction in life, and all I require is to say yes to that direction. And if life says yes to me at the same time, awesome. If it says no, then I'll prepare myself when the moment comes when life says yes. So for me, that's what I've learned from that expression, that not let the fear of living get in the way of being able to engage and enjoy what I'm experiencing right now.
Now, can you tell me a little bit about your new book, The Mastery of Life, A Toltec Guide to Personal Freedom, which I feel that we've discussed a lot of things that will help us with our own self-mastery, but tell me about your new book.
Well, it's a book that's based on my family's tradition, obviously. I used the structure of Teotihuacan in the way it was taught to me. The two-headed serpent, one represents hell, one represents heaven, and the body of the snake represents the inner journey that we go. We start in hell, you know, that moment before we have an aha moment. Then we have an aha moment, and we start through the journey. And it takes us all the way to the moment where we have faith about ourselves. And it's kind of like the way I describe, I remember Dr. Miguel Ruiz, I remember apprentice Miguel Ruiz, and I remember Don Miguel Ruiz. You can say Dr. Miguel Ruiz is one side of the head of the serpent. His journey is the body. And the head is that moment where he comes to peace with himself. The thing about putting into effect is a teacher once taught me this. The key to enlightenment is effort. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's what she said. The key to enlightenment is effort. And I wish I could tell you the name of this teacher, but I forgot. But it was her expression was just impactful. Effort is using the energy that animates this body, that animates this mind, to make a choice, to take a step forward. It's being that infinite possibility. You can think of all these things. And if you like one of them, you say yes to it. That's what effort is. Discipline is remembering to apply that effort every day. That's what discipline is. Forget about the drill sergeant. This is about remembering that I have a choice every day to take that step. Following through is what success is. So mastery of life, we're not talking about imposing my will or subjugating something or having power over. It's about practice makes the master. Because the first time you take that step forward, you realize I can do this. It's like grabbing a lesson, like going to taking a piano lesson, getting a guitar lesson, going to Tai Chi class or karate class or boxing class or art class or whatever you're first starting in a journey of what it is to, you know, work in the film industry, what it is to be create a radio show. At first, you just got to take the step forward. And the more you put it, the more you use that effort in that practice, confidence comes in. I have the confidence to be able to do it. And the more you practice even more, that confidence turns into trust. You continue to practice it even more, that trust I have in myself to be able to do it turns into faith. I can do this. And that's what we call mastery of life. That's mastery of self. I put into practice that which I've learned. And I have complete confidence in the ability to use the energy that animates this body and mind to manifest it. At first, kind of like yoga. When you first start going to a yoga class, the first few classes, and few could be the first year or 2 years, every time you go to a yoga class, you're cranking your neck to see what the teacher or instructor is doing. The yoga is doing.
Yep.
So you're doing downward dog or a baby cobra, whatever, but you turn your head to look at what the teacher's doing, kind of like you're not trusting what you know. You're putting it like if he or she is doing it, you're completely putting your attention there. But little by little, you get better and better at yoga, and you recognize the voice, you recognize the sound, you recognize the instruction, and you slowly put your head where it's supposed to be, which is looking down or up or whatever, but just having that line. You're no longer looking at the teacher. You're hearing the teacher. You have the confidence in yourself to recognize what the yogi is saying. Then you continue to practice it. Practice it now. It develops into a trust. Oh, I know I can do this. All of a sudden, you're moving and flowing with what the yogi is teaching because you have trust in yourself to do it. I trust myself to be that bendy in that position. And then faith comes in. And it comes the moment you actually use your breath to flow. You're hearing the yogi, but you're already, it's just like a musical rhythm. You know, it's like, you know, you start the song and you know where you're the beat and you're just letting the flow. And the beat is the breath. And all of a sudden, the mind turns off. Because when you're looking at the yogi, the mind's on. When you're listening to the yogi, waiting for those instructions, your mind is on. But something happens when you finally can come into the breath where the mind turns off. For me, it's in running. After mile 5 or 4, it used to be mile 7, but mile 4 or 5, I can feel the moment where I no longer am thinking. That little chatter in my head, that little monkey voice shuts up because my breath is flowing with my run. The only thing that exists is me, my body, the ground, and the cars that pass me. I have to keep attention to the cars. But I'm completely in the present moment. They call this in sports the zone. I'm in the zone where I don't have to think of what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing. I don't have to rely on the internal dialogue in my mind to let me know what's happening. I know what's happening. I don't need the monkey mind to tell me I'm present. In yoga, we can say that that is the moment where the whole movement is dictated by the breath. And you're in communion. And you have this beautiful experience. And running is the moment where you're in complete communion with your body. And meditation is the moment you're no longer focusing on meditating, you're meditating. It's like in painting. Mm-hmm. You're no longer thinking about the technique. The painting is painting itself. When you're writing a book or you're writing a script, there's the moment the script or the book is writing itself. I'm just instructing. I'm just typing away. As a writer, that happens. It's mm-hmm. a beautiful thing. It's like when all of a sudden, like you spent months, almost years, working on the clay, get to the point where all of a sudden you're working, you're writing, and you're, instead of trying to push it, you're just trying to catch up your fingers, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's writing itself because you're in the zone.
Yeah.
That's what the mastery of life is. I started with confidence, became trust, became faith. I know what I'm doing. Actually, scratch that. I have faith in what I'm doing, which is 100% without a doubt.
Now, I'm going to ask you a couple questions to ask all my guests. What is your mission in this life?
To enjoy it.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
It feels like the ultimate purpose of life is to manifest. It just manifests and manifests and manifests. In fact, that's how time is done, with action. So you can almost say that as you look at, you know, spring, we just saw life manifest all this mm-hmm. all this beauty.
Mm-hmm.
And it continues over and over. It's just this, it's like the cycle just keeps on going. It's like seeing a fire pit and the fire just keeps going, and you look at the embers flying up, but they're still at the very core of that thing. And yes, one day it'll all dissipate and it will not longer burn. But that day is not today.
Now, where can people find out more about you, your work, and purchase your new book?
Well, you can find me at my website, or my father's website. My personal one is MiguelRuizJr.com, MiguelRuizJr.com. But the family is in my father's website, which is MiguelRuiz.com, just Miguel without the Don. And the books, ones you can find us in Amazon and Barnes & Noble and your independent bookstore or indiebound.org. But yeah. And yeah, of course, we have social media and all those kind of things, yeah.
Miguel, it has been an absolute honor and privilege talking to you today. I know I've learned a lot, and I've felt it in my soul, and I hope the audience has as well, my friend. So thank you for all the great work you and your family has been doing over the years, and continued success, and the best of luck with everything you're doing, my friend. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Alex, for the opportunity to share my family's tradition with you, and hope everyone has a wonderful time.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.